Yeah, so as Ed said, what I actually do is I do early stage drug discovery. So the question is, what on earth am I possibly doing here, apart from the fact that I was a postdoc in Yorkshire many years ago, and it's nice to come back. But I guess I'm here as a customer. And as we know, the customer is always right. But we'll see how well that goes. I realized as I was listening this morning that, in a sense, my title might appear as a little slight on publishing particularly. It's not meant to be that. In fact, the whole theme of what I'm going to say is really about the idea of how scientists and publishers should be working much more closely together than they are today. So the motivation for saying that, and I have to say my certain bias, which I want to give you first of all, is because, as most of you know probably better than I do, is that scientists and different disciplines have different viewpoints on what publishing is all about and so forth. I'm actually coming from, I'm a computational biologist, so I come from that sort of background. I'm an open access advocate. I actually founded, co-founded and are editor-in-chief of one of the PLOS journals. And I actually am involved in maintaining what's called the Protein Data Bank, which is a very large database in biology. And I think that kind of is an underlying theme. I got started in this whole business by writing an editorial about 6 years ago, which basically said, is a biological journal different than a biological database? And my conclusion in all of that was the answer is no. The only difference is the way that they're perceived. You don't get tenure for publishing, or for actually depositing something in a database. You get it for putting, obviously, in good journals. But I think that reward system very slowly is beginning to change. And based on what we heard this morning and what I was thinking about, it actually came to me that probably, from my point of view, the biggest likely tipping point to really change the way publishing is done is going to be when a change in the reward system is identified. Because that will drive the customer. I'm at the leading edge. I already have tenure, so I don't really care. But when the people who are coming up for tenure start demanding of the publisher new things because their data, for example, is becoming important as part of their tenure decision, then we're going to see quite a different world, I believe. So that's kind of the sort of thrust of what I'm going to say. It's got a data component to it. So I guess I wrote this not very long ago, but this is my wish, okay? And I'll read it out because it's sort of the thesis we're going to go through in the next few minutes. As a scientist, I want an interaction with a publisher, and I now have it in inverted commas because it could be some different entity than what we would think of as a publisher today. That does not begin when the scientific process ends, but begins at the beginning of the scientific process itself. So that sounds very grandiose, or at least it does to me, but kind of what does that mean? Well, from my point of view as a scientist right now, here is the sort of workflow that we go through that you're very familiar with, I'm sure. There's ideas come about, standing in the shower or whatever. That leads to a hypothesis. From that hypothesis, you design an experiment. It generates some data, some conclusions. And then what happens is essentially the process sort of goes into a completely different mode. So I've got all this digital data. I've got all of this stuff sitting around on various drives. And suddenly, I essentially generate something which has value. Okay, I generate, let's just call it a PDF. Obviously, it has different forms, but it's essentially a valuable summary as a research article in one sense. On the other hand, I've actually lost a lot of information by formulating it in that way. So in the end, what I want to get out of all of this is I don't want to lose information. I still want something like the research article as one view on the science, but not the only view. That's the difference. And then what happens is I kind of throw it over this high wall to a publisher and sort of forget about it. Hopefully it's accepted, there's a round of review, blah, 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 and then it's published. And then I don't think about it anymore. Well, maybe the line should be somewhere else. This is what I'm interested in seeing happen. So let's say we put the line here. Well, this then brings in the notion of, well, who looks after the data at that point? You know, we have the notion of institutional repositories. I don't know how they're doing in this country, but I just came from a meeting in Denver of institutional repository people in the US, and I have to say it was a bit disappointing. I got the sense, you know, I'm making provocative statements here, but from my point of view as a scientist, what they're doing is kind of building it and they will come. When I asked about evaluation metrics for these resources in different institutions, it was basically a blank slate. So I'm not yet convinced that this could be an answer for me, but I'm not convinced it's an answer right now. So what I would really like, maybe the line is up here somewhere else, maybe it's even farther up, right? So basically, you and I have an interaction that begins right at the beginning. So the moment I jot down a few ideas, maybe that's at the point then a publisher becomes the holder of that information. The access control to it can be quite variable. I mean, it could be just for my group, it could be for a wider audience, whatever, and eventually, at some point, that becomes, in a sense, access to all. At that point, I suppose it could be considered published. So this is kind of the sort of model that we've been throwing around. And why do I want this? Why is this so important to me as a scientist? So let me give you a couple of examples. And I'm going to take them for the field at which I work, but I think you can see the general applicability here. Is that this is just a figure in a paper. Now, it happens to be a figure of a protein structure, and it's absolutely perhaps one of the worst ways to comprehend what that means, what that information means, when it's embedded either on an HTML page or on a PDF. Now, what's starting to happen, and I'll just shoot forward, is this is from Elsevier, but in Science Direct, you can now actually click on the figure and you can pull the data back from the database and actually see it displayed, and you can even move it around. So it becomes an interactive article, which is, from my point of view, is a very important first step. And that happened because there's an interrelationship at this point between a publisher and a database provider. Now, who in the end does each remains to be seen. But there's that API and that interaction now. But I would say that this is just an incremental beginning. Because what I really want to do is I really want to be able to, what I get back when I click on this figure from the Elsevier article, and I'm not singling them out, others are doing it too, and the effect's the same. What I'm getting is I'm actually getting a piece of data coming back, but it's not organized in the way that I really want. Because what happened is it comes back in a generic form. The reader is left to figure out and try and make it look the same as what's in the paper. I want the metadata that actually creates this figure exactly associated with the article. So I don't actually see it necessarily, but it's there because there's a lot of knowledge buried in that metadata that allows that figure to be presented and then rendered and interactively moved around by the reader. That's currently lost. So we've made one small step forward, but we still are not capturing a lot of the knowledge that I really want. That's the point. Of course, to do that is, you know, this is no mean feat. This requires a lot of standards. It requires calling interfaces. It requires people to cooperate. But it's starting to happen in some form, as we saw here. It can go farther. So already, databases and publishers, and all of you, are using multiple formats, including mobile. Well, what I'd really like to see is how those are integrated together. So if you're integrating the data and the publication together, then you should have applications that allow you to actually review that. So just as you can go right now and sort of, you know, pull up stuff on your mobile phone from a given publisher or a given article, we want to do that with this integrated information. We want to do that in such a way, of course, that it can be shared. And we're going to hear about perhaps some of the failures so far of Web 2.0 technologies. But certainly, I think this kind of notion takes the whole social bookmarking and aspect of things to the next level, because it's not talking about a paper or a set of data, both of which now are available as Web 2.0 deliverables, but it actually puts them together. So that's sort of one of the things I want, okay? Then I want integrated rich media that can improve comprehension. What publishers are doing right now, which is great, is actually having embedded video with articles, okay? This is great. What I'm not seeing at this point really is an integration between those things and the media itself. So let me give you an example of that, and it's sort of on the next slide. What I want to be able to do is I want to be able to have different views. So when I'm looking at the materials and methods, what I really want is a video presentation that describes that, because it's so much more meaningful than I would actually get just from reading that in the text, when I actually see that experiment being done. But I want that delivered to me as I'm looking. Either I actually look at the, I'm watching the video of the experiment, and when I click on the video, I see the piece of text from the paper that associates with it, or I'm just reading the paper, I get stuck as to what's going on, I click, and up pops the author and a view of exactly that experiment being done. The technologies to do all of that are actually there already. There's no real impediment from a technological point in doing any of this. The problem is that it remains too difficult. So we've tried to do this. I should say, off the bat, I'm involved with co-founded a company called Sivi.tv, which is actually integrating these kinds of things. Now, there's been some success and failure, I would say. So the problem is that even though it's relatively easy to do for the author, basically the author uploads a video and then they upload the paper or whatever and they integrate the two together on a website, pretty straightforward. Why would I do it? The incentive is not there for them to do it. They've already published, the papers come out months ago, and there's just not, even though I tell them, which is, you know, it's part of the business model, that in fact, if you actually do this, then you get more citations on the paper because it draw the video and other things, which are of course indexed in various other places, actually draw people to the paper. But getting the barrier to doing it is, you know, it's still too high. So those barriers have to be lowered. Where it does work much more successfully is just in actually doing things that are in a more formative stage. Like you can integrate video or podcast content with posters. So as someone looks at the poster on the screen, you click a bit of the poster, and suddenly the author starts a podcast or whatever comes on talking about that particular part of the paper, of the poster. So in its formative stage, that seems to be something that people do, because at that point, they're really keen on promoting that work. Sometimes they don't want to, of course, but most people really want to promote the work at that stage. So this is happening in some form, but the integration of rich media into the traditional scholarly pipeline is still somewhat limited. Now, is there a tipping point to that? Is there a point where this could actually change? I don't know, but what we're trying to do right now is to develop something that would actually allow it to happen much more readily. Because I would argue, if we're standing in this wonderful lecture theater, it has an incredible multimedia system. The other part of it is, it's also rather expensive. All right. And most classrooms I teach in don't have any of this access. Most times I go and listen to a lecture in a university from a very great speaker or whatever else, there isn't this kind of access. And yet what I would claim is we pretty much have in our pockets right now all of the technology to actually make a presentation. So this is sort of how we envisage it working, and we're just sort of looking into this right now. And the idea is that would be some kind of supplement to a traditional scholarly output. So if I actually give a presentation about one or more papers that I've actually published, that could actually become adjunct material as a podcast to the paper, which I think some people would like, if it was easy to do. So the basic idea to make it easy is you essentially turn on your smartphone, you record a podcast, and then you have a small piece of software. Right now, you're there with a laptop and a PowerPoint presentation, just like I am here. As I use my smartphone to change the slide, as it's being recorded, basically, that records a little sync file. At the end of my talk, I just press another button. The sync file, the slide, and the podcast are all loaded to a Web 2.0 site. And basically, within minutes, the presentation becomes online. So those kinds of innovations, I'm not saying it's a particularly good one, it's just an example, I think would create far more, say, podcasting material than we currently have available and done easily. Now you might say, well, the quality's not going to be very good. Well, it turns out when you survey people who listen to the science content online, what you find is that they're not particularly concerned about high quality. As long as they can listen to it and it's easy to comprehend, it doesn't have to be of the highest quality. So basically, you know, this is another example of how we could integrate things into the pipeline. So why do I keep coming back to this question, why do I want this? Why do I want a different relationship to you? And why is the data so important to that relationship? Well, here's another example. And it revolves around semantic linking of data that can lead to new knowledge discovery. All right? This just, if you imagine a mashup of the data associated with the experiments, and then some form of end result, let's call it a paper, if you consider, then you can have different views on this, as I've said already. So one of those views would actually come from the database. So that's what we're looking at here. What we're actually looking at is a piece of data in the database. It just so happens to be a structure in this case. All right. So what's the big deal? Well, because that structure has, in this case, it also has a digital object identifier. And it means that I can actually go, it also has its own unique database identifier. I can go into, in this case, PubMed Central, into a corpus of open access content, and I can find all references to that piece of data. Now, why is that important? It's important because that data is probably not cited. So you know who really loves this? It's the people who published the papers originally and deposited the data in the database. Because they actually discover how people are using their data that they would have not otherwise discovered. Because it's not the people who are using their data didn't cite it, but they reference it in the text of the paper. So we're just basically bringing that information together so that, in this case, that the author could actually see how people are using their data. You can take that a step further, and this is like the absolute low-hanging fruit. This doesn't require a lot of machine learning, data mining, or any of this stuff. This is really, even I can write scripts to do this, okay? What it also gives you is I have a piece of data in a paper that wasn't cited in the paper associated with that data is not cited in the paper I'm looking at, but I can identify the data, as I just described. What's also very useful is I can see what other data sets are associated in that paper. So I actually gain knowledge about, I make discoveries about relationships that other people have found between my data and a bunch of other sets of data. So just by, the point being, by integrating together data and the knowledge about that data, I've actually learned something new. And you can actually take that to a different level and then sort of represent it in a different way, all of which is also very easy to do and is essentially a giveaway. So in this case, what I have here is a network graph. It doesn't really matter what it is, but let's just pretend each of these nodes, these boxes, is a genes, okay? Now, a line is drawn between two genes if they happen to be mentioned in the same paper. And the thicker the line, you can't really see it from here, the more times they're referenced together. So all I've done is to scan the literature looking for these names, and I've come up with this graph. Well, already this graph has some characteristics. I can learn something from all of this that I wouldn't have otherwise had. And it comes from having this, you know, the notion of the data integrated with the knowledge. So what I see here is I have this cluster of nodes that are interrelated. And when I actually look where those nodes came from, I see that they're all in the immunology literature. And then I have this common node here, which is interesting. And if I look at the others, I see that they're in the cardiac disease literature for the most part. But there's an intersection with this one particular gene. And it may be that these people, this essentially reflects a shared function across these two different domains. And it's quite possible that the people who read the cardiac disease literature never read the literature on immunology, and vice versa. So there's a discovery aspect that's gone on here by virtue of putting the data and the knowledge about that data together. And this is the kind of thing, as a scientist, I really want to see, which is completely missing right now. Why else do I want this? Well, I'm now pushing back beyond the data all the way up to the original experiment. And this is where I make a confession. And my confession is that mine, and along with most other laboratories I know, do not actually manage our digital output very well at all. In fact, it's a disaster. You know, we use project management tools, things like Basecamp and so forth, but there's still a lot to be desired. So it turns out the intellectual memory of my laboratory is mainly in my email folders. So I have an email folder for projects, for people, and so on, and there's too much of a hub and spoke. There's not the kind of knowledge sharing kind of environment you would look. So I call this is an unhealthy, this is the truth. And I want to get past this, and I want to get past this so it becomes organized and it becomes the beginning of what was the publishing process. So just to sort of embarrass myself even further, This is also the truth of mine and many other labs. All right, I generate way more negative data. Negative data is important. I mean, there's no way it's ever going to be published in a form, but it's very important to people doing experiments. That right now is lost. There is no association of that negative data with, for the most part, with ultimately the published paper. That needs to change. My content management is a mess. So, how I have slides and posters and lab notebooks, none of that is in any really, we use electronic notebooks and so forth, but there's a lot of this information is just lost. If you believe this podcasting notion that I just described to you, where it's a matter of turning on a smartphone and actually making a podcast, well, we could be recording journal clubs right now. And those journal clubs, this is an example, we have journal clubs and there's slides associated with them and the paper, but all of that basically gets lost, and it's certainly not available to other people. I would actually really like to hear and listen, maybe not to all of it, but if you've got this synchronized podcast, I could flip through the slides of someone else's lab doing a journal club on a paper, maybe even one of my papers, but a paper from another that I'm interested in, and I can flip through the slides and see the discussion they had, and then I say, oh, that part sounds interesting. I click on that, and basically the podcast starts by the journal club discussion at that point. A good point to actually have all that data together would actually be what now is called the publication itself. So it would actually, in my view, enrich the so-called research article if these other components were readily accessible from it. I mean, there's a lot of debate about this, obviously. Another part of that is, of course, of all the methods, and I'll get to why all this is important a bit more in a second, but, we basically, all of the software we develop is open source, but, where is it? When the graduate student leaves the lab, everything disappears, everything sort of goes to pot, basically. And in fact, we and other people have looked at this. Some of you probably know there's a thing called the Nucleic Acids Research Database issue and the server issue in the life sciences, where each year it's a sort of catalog of these resources. Well, if you go back and look at those resources, which are really about published, they're published papers about data and so forth, and web servers, in 1 year, pretty much 10% of those are gone. They're just not there anymore. If they are, you can't find them. Some of them have new URLs and you can hunt around and get to them. And then basically 10% a year disappear after that. So the persistence of this stuff right now is very poor. And as scientists, we really ought to be doing a better job. I think, and there's no question, if you then sort of map that into why I want this, it comes down in part to reproducibility. I'd say reproducibility is sort of one of these dirty things in science that we put under the rug. We believe when we publish papers that the experiments are reproducible. When we go and read other people's papers, they're rarely reproducible without actually going back to the original authors, at least at some level, and getting the data, which of course is not necessarily, most often not there. So this is sort of one of the motivations for me in actually wanting this kind of change. The other, of course, is the preservation of the digital record, which I already alluded to. Right now, journals do a wonderful job of preserving the knowledge about that data, but don't really have anything to do, for the most part, with the data itself. This was brought up this morning, but we're in this era of the changing role of the library and the notion of emerging institutional repositories, some more developed than others. But I think there's a huge role to play in this process here. So it becomes a partnership between the scientist, the library, and the publisher in a way that we just don't have today. And then the other part of it is that management of data in general. It's true in this country as well, but also in the US, there are programs from the NIH, NSF, and so forth that support data. They actually have data policies now. The NSF just came out with a new data policy, all requiring data to be deposited and so forth. The problem is that most of the money so far has gone into a very small number of very large data sets. In actual fact, the reality of it is a huge long tail. So there's a very large number of small data sets that just basically get lost, and actually most of those then prevent any kind of reproducibility of the experiment after a year or two, I would argue. So I'd say we're doing a pretty poor job there, And that's what I call the long tail. So what will it take for us to get past this impasse and basically do something, have a new kind of relationship? Well, here's a couple of ideas at least. And we actually in January, I guess, had a workshop called Beyond the PDF, which explored these kinds of notions. It's not necessarily meant to put down the PDF. The PDF is a very valuable entity, and you can imagine that it's persisting in various forms. That's not the point, but the point is that there's more to life than just the PDF. But how do we get there? Well, first of all, we need to have a lot of tools to make this kind of workflow capture that I described actually workable. So at the end of this process, I could effectively press a button and publish something. By publishing, mean making it generally available. Okay. What's clear is that there are a lot of wonderful tools out there, and I'll give you a couple of examples in a minute, that do some of these things. The problem right now, in my view, is that there's no cohesion. And maybe that's just the state of the art. But there's a lot of people out there, there's a lot of scientists out there who, in part out of frustration and seeing the promise in this new digital era of sort of, you know, what we basically call, essentially the electronic printing press of the 21st century, who are actually taking matters into their own hands. But they're doing it in isolation. But what we might see, what's beginning to happen, I think, is the notion that these ideas are beginning to coalesce into some tools that will work together, which of course involves new standards. There's lots of rights and access issues, of course, that all have to be sorted out. I mean, I'm glossing over, you know, years of problems. And then what I think what's really missing, and I've been pushing on this, and I'd be really happy to talk to anyone who has any interest in trying to do something in this space, you know, is to actually get a publisher to commit to trying an experiment in really doing this sort of soup to nuts workflow kind of capture and new kind of publication. So if you have any interest in that, I'd love to hear about it. So it all sounds insurmountable, but as I said already, there are a bunch of tools out there already, and these are just ones that, you know, just a subset of things. There's a lot more. Most of the ones that were discussed at the Beyond the PDF workshop are not even there. But certainly, all of these things could begin to be working together. And some things are being happening. There's also a bunch of really great ideas out there, so which also, I think, at some point have got to have impact. The idea of nanopublications, and you can make of that what you will, and the definition is abused and misused, and I'd certainly misuse it. But, you know, from my point of view as a scientist, I don't necessarily... The notion of a journal is just dead, sorry. I very rarely look at a journal. I mean, it's true I get electronic table of contents and I'll glance through it, but the concept of a journal is really lost on me now. It's really... components, objects, data and knowledge objects at a much lower level. So it could be actually research articles, but it could actually be components of those articles, even down to some very simple axiom within those articles, which perhaps could be constituted as a nano publication. So the idea we're seeing semantic tagging, which is also, you know, it's being done in PDFs, it's being done in other means, and clearly these are important navigation tools and important things to happen. And they're starting to be used more. The notion of citation ontologies, the notion of essentially a way of scholarly HTML, which are sort of extensions that allow you to actually write these kinds and maintain the kinds of workflows that I was talking about, which requires the associated authoring tools to make those happen. Now, right now in the PLOS journals, it's probably true of your journals, you know, 95% of the papers come in Microsoft Word. In our case, the rest come in LaTeX, pretty much. So there's a lot of opportunity there to do things with even within Microsoft Word. And people like Microsoft are interested in doing that, and a number of us have written plugins that work with Word already. The problem is, so, for example, we've written a Word plugin that does semantic tagging. All right, so it's a bit like the spell checker. So as you type, it basically goes out to various ontologies and says, well, let's just make it simple, like a taxonomy. If I type a particular species, it goes out and checks to see if that's the one I meant or I meant something else. and I can then accept that. So I might use a common name for the species, but it offers me the systematic name, which I can either ignore, accept, or actually tag to the article, but not actually expose by default. So what I've created is a hook. I've created a semantic tag, which then can immediately relate to many other articles if they were done in the same way. So, and it's done at the point of authoring. So it's a bit like the video capture or the podcast capture has to be done at the time that it's actually being given. So why isn't this a great success? Well, partly because, you know, there's no incentive to use things like this now. But that's starting to change, and publishers are starting to adopt them and so on. And the idea that if things get fast-tracked, for example, if these kinds of tools were used, would actually, I would surmise, authors might actually start using them. Remains to be seen. So what came out of this workshop, just to end, is the idea that it's no good talking about these things. I go back to my department in the university, and I start talking. They say, where have you been? I said, oh, I was at UKSG, because no one knows what that is. And I tell them what we're doing here, and it's really not on their radar. It's only going to get on their radar when they see science done in a way that's actually different. This will come. It is coming. That actually where this process made a difference. So that's what we're actually trying to address at the moment with a specific project, spinal muscular atrophy. And so what we're trying to do is to actually, this is a disease that's been designated by the NIH as something that is actually treatable. It's essentially a disease that affects young children. And the idea is to actually come up ultimately with better sets of treatments. There are already drugs out there, but there are issues. So the idea is to actually, and there's a lot of corpus of information on this that's very disparate. The idea is to take that corpus, and Elsevier have been kind enough, for example, as one publisher, to open their corpus to this, so that this data can be mined in the kind of, and the associated online data and databases, to actually try and address a specific problem that's going to affect people's lives through the kinds of workflow, the beginnings of the kind of workflow I talked about. So if that was to happen, which is a big if, then that would begin to get some attention, and that would be a driver, I believe, for scientists to pay more attention and to begin pushing harder on these important changes. So with that, I'll stop, and I'll thank you very much. And these are just people who have worked on this and the Beyond the PDF workshop, which is somewhat of a motivation for giving this talk. So thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for a couple questions. We've got, I think the way we're going to work it is there's the 3 and 4 mic back there, if you want to actually go up to those mics, and these mics, 1 and 2 in the front, should actually come off and can be passed around. So you can go to either or. We have people here who can bring the mic to you if you're down front. Any questions? Number 4 there?
My name is Brad Meyer from Collaboration Limited. I want to give you a quick story. We had subject matter experts who had written tomes that nobody was opening. They were very excited about what they'd written, but no one was reading. So we sat down over coffee with a video camera, and we asked them, why would I bother looking at the first bit of this? Why would I bother looking at the next bit? And what came out of them was all their excitement and all their passion about the subjects. And when we combined that video with the transcript of that video and made it searchable along with the tome, they became the bestsellers within their subject.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen exactly the same thing, because when a scientist talks about their work, they get really excited. And when you see that excitement passed on, it's just dramatic. And just a couple of sort of follow-ons to that. One is that it's not just at scientists. The director of the National Science Foundation in the US looked at a video that was made, a poster cast, where it was actually a high school student from actually one of the worst performing school districts in the US, which is between San Diego and the Mexican border. And believe me, when you say worst performing school districts in the US, that's pretty bad. But it was so motivational. She was so into what she was saying about this. And it was about a complex, a rhodopsin, you know, a complex protein. So that sort of comes, it's a different medium. And we really need to explore that medium. Another example, which I realized was, in a sense, well, this is what happened, is that a student left the lab and she had a paper published. One evening, she was Skyping with a friend of hers when they were talking about the paper. At some point, they decided to record it. Well, then she posted that along with her paper. And what I realized is instead of just one person or talking about their paper, which can be okay depending on who they are, this was a discussion. And it was like, it was sort of, I realized we're kind of reinventing broadcasting here. I mean, broadcasting realized many years ago it's much more engaging to have a conversation than it is to have one person talking about the thing. And it actually became, you know, and what you see is that people listen to this, then they go and get the paper. So, you know, we've got good stats that show that the access to papers when you have this kind of, these kinds of capabilities really, really do, you know, drive things forward.
Great, thank you. Any last quick question before we move on? Okay, thanks again, Phil.
Thank you.